You know, when we started this lesson last week, and this series of lessons last week called Out of the Old, In with the New, and we got right to the middle of page 4, and so if you have one of those handouts, and what we did last week was we laid the foundation with a lot of Bible, and I'll never apologize for that. You can't get too much of that. I've never met anybody that overdosed on Bible, okay, and in a negative way. But I have met a people that got as much as they could, and it turned out to be a positive thing. But when we looked at last week, and we started last week, and if you weren't here last week, I would encourage you to take this lesson with you and look up some of these verses. In fact, if you were here last week, look up some of these verses, mark your Bible, underline it, highlight it with anything but a black highlighter. And four of you got that. Anybody? And Ronnie's heard that 25 times. And every time about four people get it. And then 5 minutes later, somebody will go, ha! They just got the black highlighter thing, okay? But at any rate, yeah. I mean, you know, what am I saying? What I am saying is become familiar with your Bible. And when I say become familiar with your Bible, I'm obviously implying become familiar with the Bible. But become familiar with your Bible. You know, I don't know that there's anything more special in the Christian life outside of the people that you love and God's put in your life, and it may be whether it's family or friends, equally to the Word of God and owning a Bible. And I don't know what you know about, you know, other places in the country, not in the country, but in the world, and hopefully not in the country, but in some places it's against the law to have a Bible. It's against the law to give out a Bible. It's against the law to read the Bible. And we're privileged to be able to own a copy of the Word of God. There's more Bibles that's been printed than any other book in the world. And it is still the number one bestseller, but I wonder if it's the number one best reader. You know, I don't know how many Bibles I have owned in my life, and it's not hundreds or anything like that. But I did have one, and I've said this before. In fact, I think I mentioned it Wednesday night. I did have one that I owned for about probably 20 years and never read it until after I got saved. And so, you know, the Bible doesn't jump in your lap, you know, but if you read it, it'll jump in your life. It'll jump in your heart and in your mind, and it'll set you on a good path. But when you take these verses that we talked about last week and become familiar with them, because your foundation, as far as the Christian life goes, is important. Many people, and I'm not saying I'm not one of them, but many people don't know how to, and it's not about being able to articulate it, but scripturally speaking, their struggle as a Christian is not knowing really what took place when they got saved. You know, not how they got saved, but like, what did you get? If I were to ask you the question, and I'm not asking for a response, but you can toss it around in your own mind, but what did you get when you got saved? You know, I'm going to tell you, and I can tell you, generally speaking, if you want to just find out, you got a lot. We got a lot. And most of us, the typical response to that question is, well, I got eternal life. Yes, you did. And that started the day that you got saved. And most of us, when we think about eternal life, what do we think about? Or where do we think about? Heaven. Anybody there yet? Okay. All right. I'm not rushing it. You know, don't jump out in front of anything that'll take you there. But I'm just saying, we're not there yet. But that eternal life started that day. November 29, 1984 started for me. God gave me, by His grace, through faith, God gave me the gift of eternal life. And that night, in fact, it was a Thursday night, and I went forward. I've shared this before, shared most of what I don't have one story, so, you know, it's just me and my world and now in God's. But I remember the night that I got saved, I was by myself, and then I went forward. I talked to who was then, at that time, an associate pastor in the church that Vicki and I were attending, and we were in his Sunday school class. It was a singles class. Imagine me and Vicki in a singles class. How about that? You know what I mean? You know, we weren't married. She's my girl. You know, but she still is my girl, though. Don't misunderstand that. But and I don't have any other ones except for my three daughters. But I remember we were sitting in that class, and I was so out of place, and I was so I don't even know how to describe it. You know, I mean, I was like a potato in a potato in a bowl of applesauce. I mean, it was just, it was really out of my element. And I'm going to tell you, I'm going to be honest with you, I wasn't comfortable there. I wasn't comfortable in that environment. But when I continued to listen that particular day, so this is the first Sunday, in other words, the first Sunday that I went to church as a saved man. And I went about four times before that as an adult. And then not at all when I was a kid, about four or five times when I was a kid. But I remember sitting in that class and not knowing at the time. Now remember, I got saved the previous Thursday night, not really knowing what I did because I was by myself. And I was reading some literature, and I prayed and asked the Lord to come into my life and asked Christ to forgive me of my sins. I did get saved, but I didn't really know what it all involved and if I did the right thing. So fast forward to that Sunday, and at the end of that class, like we do in here on occasion, I say more so than not, as the Spirit leads, I just felt the conviction to give an invitation in here. And that the same thing happened when we were in that Sunday. And the guy that was teaching the class, his first name is Dale, and he just asked everybody in the class to bow their heads and close their eyes and is there anything, y'all need a seat?
No.
Oh, okay, waiting on coffee, okay, just check. All right, and so as he was doing that, he asked everybody in the class, he said, and so I just want you to bow your heads and close your eyes. And of course, I was happy to do that. You know, that was the easiest thing that I could do because I didn't know anything about what he was talking about. And so as I did, he just asked, if you're in here and you're not 100% sure if you died right now and you go to heaven, he said, I just want you to look up at me. And man, I don't know anything but to explain it, but God, you know, because, you know, I know that there's supposed to be a message that goes to your brain that tells your head to go like this, but I don't know anything about that message. My head just went whoop, and I just started looking up. And I looked up at him, and I was very emotional about it because I didn't know really what all that involved. And then he just simply said, okay. He said, you can put your head down. And I did. And at the end of the class, he explained to me what it meant to be saved. And then I explained to him what I did the previous Thursday night. And we concluded I did the right thing, and I invited Christ to come into my life. I got saved that night. And then he said to me, he said, Rick, the next thing you need to do, and I know this is elementary for a lot of you, so hold on. And some of us that have been, some of you have been maybe say 20 years, maybe this is a reminder, it might be an enlightenment to you. He said, the next thing you need to do is get baptized. And he explained that to me. He said, you know, it's just a step of obedience. He said, you're already saved. It doesn't make you any more saved than you already are. It's a step of obedience, and you're publicly displaying what Christ did for you. When you're standing in that water, that means you believe that Jesus died on the cross. When you're lowered into that water, that means you believe that he was buried. And when you're raised back up out of the water, it means that you believe that he rose from the grave. He said, and that's the first thing you ought to do, is follow the Lord believer's baptism. And then I trusted him. I didn't know him that well, but I knew him well enough. I mean, if anybody's going to tell the truth to you, hopefully it's a preacher, you know? And so I said, okay, I'll do that. And he said, well, after the service, right at the very end of the service, and this is hopefully maybe to give you some information because we do the same thing here. At the end of the service, which would be our 10:30 worship service, he said, you'll notice, and he was talking to me like I was kind of like in second grade Christianity, but he didn't know I was in K-3, okay? But I was born 3 months premature, but I'm born again. And so as he was saying, he said, at the end of the service, right at the very end, there's what's called an invitation. And you'll notice, more than likely, there'll be some people that come forward. And the pastor will talk about joining the church or asking Christ to come into your life or getting baptized. He said, at that time, he said, you come forward. He said, and I'll meet you there. And then I'll explain what we'll do from there. It's making a public profession of your faith. It's showing other people what you did. And the baptism does the same thing. And that's the order that we do it. So I thought, you know, that's fine. I'll do that. I was reluctant. I was afraid. I was nervous. And that's a common response to that. So as I did, I sat in the second row, or Vicky and I did, and so it would be a short walk, you know, and so it was like kind of like this. It was like, we're sitting here at the end of the second row, and I just kind of, all I had to do was go like this, you know, and step up, because I was afraid. I was very nervous about the whole thing. I was nervous about everything that was going on. And so the service ends, and the, you know, right toward that time, and you know, they made that, they asked me a couple questions. Rick, you know, what'd you come forward for? And well, I invited Christ to come into my life, and they acknowledged that and everything like that. And then right after that, they did it this way. We don't necessarily do it this way. There's not a right and a wrong way. But the people that make decisions stand at the front after the service is over, and then a lot of the church members come by and encourage them, which is a great thing, you know. But again, I'm kind of ready to hit the parking lot, you know what I'm saying? I'm like, this is more than happened to me, you know, in any event that I've ever been around. And so I'm just standing there, people coming by, and we're really happy for you. And I'm, man, this is awesome, great decision. And they knew way more about it than I did. And then this one guy came up to me and he shook his hand, shook my hand. He goes, man, I bet you're on fire right now. I didn't know what to say. And, you know, it didn't come out of my mouth though, but I'm thinking, I hope not. I don't know what that means. You know, I thought this is what trumps that. You know what I'm saying? I don't want to be on fire. Is that what I did? You know, so I said all that to say this is that was all, I mean, all, you know, in caps, all brand new. It was all brand new. And the Lord has helped me, and I know He's helped a lot of people around this ministry as well, who have had, we've had, you know, the privilege, and that's for anybody that that feels led to have the privilege to serve in this ministry or ministries like it, just to be around folks that are right there where I was. You know, just out of the gate. Just ask Christ to come into their life. Just start growing, if they start growing at all. And coming into these doors. And by the way, I guarantee you, and I'm not trying, I would never have ever put anybody on the spot, so don't worry about that. There's some of those in here right now. I don't know who they are, and I don't pretend to know who they are, but I know this, just out of the gate. You've been saved, or maybe you're thinking about getting saved. And you're at that crossroad. And if you're thinking about getting saved, that's where you're at. You're at that crossroad. You know, whether to receive Christ as your Savior or not, or, you know, am I going to buy into this? And God's doing a work in your life. And by the way, if He wasn't doing a work in your life and you're in here this morning and you've never invited Christ to come into your life, you being here gives evidence to the fact that He's doing a work in your life. If you have been saved, and maybe you just got saved, or maybe you kind of jumped ship and you got off the trail a little bit, and you're here this morning, that's evidence that God's working in your life. Why? Because He loves you. He loves you if you're not saved. He loves you if you are saved. He loves you if you're not backslid. He loves you if you are backslid. He loves you anyway. And so there's nothing you and I can do to perform enough for God to be good and to get better and stuff like that in and of ourselves unless there's a change of the heart. See, the entire Word of God is about one thing primarily, redemption. Bringing man back to the way that he was. Now, that's not going to happen in a literal sense till heaven. But it can happen in a spiritual sense here. And the terminology as far as the Bible is concerned, and that's most important, is born again. Born anew. Saved. You know, so when that happens, it gives the opportunity for any man or woman, boy or girl, to have a renewed heart that changes the behavior. So it is out with the old, and that's what most of us are more familiar with. We know about that, and many people, and I'm just trying to lay some groundwork for what we're going to do, what we're going to pick up on page 4, but many people have the out with the old, not necessarily down pat, but I say it in this sense, and you understand it when I describe it this way. The out with the old, as far as, you know, our emotions and mentally speaking and our actions, is what we're not supposed to do. You know what I mean? I mean, and most of us know those things. In fact, most of us knew those things before getting saved. You know, I knew there was things in my life that should not be in my life. I knew that. But when I was enlightened by a relationship with Jesus Christ and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, then He awakens me and quickens me, makes me alive spiritually, to be more sensitive to those things that God is opposed to, not pleased with. Listen, that'll hurt me because He loves me. Because Jesus said it, the objective of the devil is what? To do 3 things primarily. Steal, kill, and destroy. Now God wants to keep that from happening. And what He'll keep that from happening by my participation. And so He makes me sensitive to what those old things are. But most of us would agree, and I'm not trying to get you to buy into my argument here, but most of us would agree, like, we are sensitive to those old things. Right off the bat. We know. You know, when I started smoking weed and drinking again after I got saved, right off the bat, I knew it. I knew it. I was like, no, this is not something God wants you to do. And if you stick around and do it long enough, He's going to show you really, really He don't want you to do it.
You know? Amen to that.
Now, you want to stick around long enough, He'll throw another really in it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? He's got as many reallys as you want. Yeah. You know? And the beauty of that is, again, I keep on going, I'm not going back to it just for the sake of being redundant, but the beauty of that is because He loves us. He loves us. You that have children wouldn't want your children to do anything that would hurt them. You try everything that you can possibly do to steer them in the right direction for good, for their good, because what are you trying to do? You're trying to teach them those new things, those good things. And so many of us have got off track because, and I'm not saying don't do this, but because we focus more on those old things and less on finding out. By being in environments like this, in a church environment, or a Bible study, or what have you, or reading the Bible on your own, and we fail to find out and learn and get enlightened to and apply what the new things are. What the new things are. Why did God leave me around for 30 years since I've been saved? And I'm not saying He does that for everybody, and some people are. Why did He do that? So I could learn what those new things are. So I could experience them. I could experience the new life in Christ. And it'll be good for me, and hopefully sooner or later, and hopefully sooner than later, it'll be good for somebody else. You know, and that's not just to get, it's to get and to give. And then to get and to give, it's to give it away. And so look down there at the middle of page 4. Is it already getting cold? We'll be sensitive to our people. We aim to please. Is it really getting cold? Some of you are already getting cold? Ronnie, can you just put that up a couple notches? Or Scott, can I? We got at least 2 people here now. What a thermostat. Right. Thank you, Scott. So what is done? We left off right in the middle of page 4. What is done? Old things are passed away. Now you're going to notice that we're probably going to spend maybe a week, if it's that, on the old things, and then we're going to spend about a year and a half on the new things. You know, there lies the balance, okay? I was talking to somebody not too long ago. In fact, it was within the last couple of days. I had lunch with somebody who's involved in the struggle, and I tried to describe Most Excellent Way. And really, Most Excellent Way is about teaching the Word of God, introducing people, if they're interested, in introducing people to Christ so they can have a born-again experience and have a relationship with God through His Son, Jesus Christ, and then teaching them how to live the Christian life. That's what we do. Every environment that we have, we teach the Bible. And so with that in mind, I said, you know, when you come into Most Excellent Way, you won't hear a whole lot about addiction, you know, because on Wednesday nights or an average Sunday morning, we got a classroom of trained professionals, you know what I'm saying? I mean, why? Really? We need to talk a whole lot about that. I mean, you could teach me, and we could swap addiction stories for the rest of our lives, and it would be counterproductive. It would be productive. You know, what do I need to know more about what I did that I need to get away from? And we're going to find out that the Bible really teaches about that, and we're going to talk about it today as far as, you know, what I need to be learning and what I don't need to be focusing on. You know, so we'll learn some of these old things today, and then for the rest of our life we're going to learn the new things, okay? Look at old things are passed away. Salvation can and will produce a great change in our character. And that's just not just making us a goody two-shoes. It does from the inside out. It changes the person. I could point around this room, and I won't, of the people that are just that are completely different than they were when they came here. And I'm not giving the credit to this ministry at all. I give the glory to God, and the if the credit goes to anybody, it goes to Him. But I can tell you what, there was no doorway, there was no kind of like detector or anything like that. They walked through and went bing, and then they just ended up that way. It was their effort placed in the Word of God and the Word of God in their life that brought about the change, but they're completely different. And when I use the word character, that's kind of synonymous, that's a general term, you know, with integrity, with honesty, with morality, you know, and those things like that. God changes the person, and there is a great change in the character. Not calling the person a character, you know what I'm saying? I mean, Ronnie's a character, you know what I'm saying? But I'm telling you, anybody's got character. So that was a little cleanup after I insulted him. He knows what I'm talking about. I love him to the day I die, okay? Romans chapter 6 and verse 17. Look what the Bible says. That's what matters. But God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin. See the past tense there? But ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered you. He's talking about the gospel, the truth of God's word. Again in verse 22. Now being made free from sin, there's a position right there. Now who's he talking to? He's talking to Christians. He's talking to Christians whether they're struggling or whether they're not. He said, being made free from sin. I'll tell you, if you don't get anything else this morning, that's who you are in Christ. You're free from sin. You say, Rick, I still sin. That doesn't mean you're not free from sin. In Romans chapter 6 and verse 14, prior to that, Paul said, sin shall no longer have dominion over you. And so that's your position in Christ. What do we need to do? We need to learn how to live like we are. And it's that simple. I know it seems complicated, and the struggle is a little bit more intense than just saying those words, but it's still fact. It's still Bible fact. It says, now being made free from sins and become servants to God, you have your fruit unto holiness. In other words, that fruit, that word fruit, is what's the manifestation of that? What does it reveal? What is the byproduct of that? The byproduct of that is, or the result of that is, holiness. Now, anybody want to raise their hand and say, I'm there? Not me. But that's who you are in Christ. And the fruit of your life in my life, and folks, the sooner we get this, the better off we're going to be. The fruit of your life and my life ought to be holiness. Be holy, God said. Why? Because I'm holy. And if I'm supposed to be Christ, if I'm supposed to be Christ-like, if I'm supposed to be, and I am, there's a place in the jungle. In fact, it was a term that was very common among believers centuries ago, perhaps, and even longer, and in some cultures now. God followers. And if I am a God follower, then I should be following after holiness. And I can tell you right now, that's convicting to even say. Mm-hmm. But what's God looking for? Perfection? No. Progress? Yeah. A good way to apply it and to kind of flesh it out in our lives today, am I more holy this year than I was last year? Am I more godly? Do I have more integrity and character and honesty in my life, morality in my life, than I did in the past? You know, if you can answer that with a practical yes, then you're moving forward. It's not an arrival, okay, because we still have to live in this flesh. But your fruit under holiness and the end, there's the end of it, everlasting life. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 9. When having described the old nature and its sin, he says this, lie not one to another, seeing that you have put off the old man with his deeds, and that obviously speaks to behavior, and put on the new man. Maybe it is that many of us would not actually deny that old things pass away, but we struggle with identifying what these things, old things are, and how the passing away of them affects the way that we live. We can only look once again to the Bible and see how it illustrates the old versus the new. There's a change in nature, and so there's a change in feeling. And so stick with me, and we're going to talk about that, because I don't want you to get all wrapped up with the Christian life being about a bunch of feelings. But if we're not too careful, we will disassociate ourselves from feelings by mistake, because feelings are a part of the Christian life. I mean, when you worship, I don't know about you, I love that last song. I mean, that's one of my favorite songs, in here, out of here, whatever. That's one of my favorite songs. I mean, I was emotional about that song. I had feeling about that song. I didn't know they were going to sing that song, and that didn't happen until that song played. What it had everything to do with? It had everything to do with God. And so, but you can't allow your feelings to dictate your life. Because our feelings, and this is important. Now, this is not psychobabble, but our feelings are fickle. You know, for example, you could say, I don't feel saved. Well, if you're at the Cave Lady Bar till 4 in the morning, you probably don't feel saved, okay? Don't go Googling Cave Lady Bar, okay? There might be one, but I'm not talking about a specific location. But I'm saying, but I would say this too. What brought you there, you might not feel saved. But if you are saved, when you get there, you'll feel saved. Because God will remind you. Get out of here. Okay? Leave. I remember Scott sent, I forget what day it was, sent a text message to a couple people that I was one of the recipients of. And he sent a verse. And it was, and I looked at the text. It was 4:15 in the morning. Yeah. It's 4:15 in the morning. I looked at that text message and I was like, it's about 8 for me, you know what I mean? And I looked out the text back and I said, the only thing God ever told me at 4:15 in the morning is get to the house. But what? Those are two different feelings. You know what I'm saying? Thank the Lord he was in his Bible at 4:15 in the morning and God wouldn't tell me to get to the house, all right? Did any of that make any sense at all? But the bottom line is, when you say, listen, you cannot, I wouldn't say anything to try to confuse you, but don't discard your feelings. You know what I mean? I mean, I've tried to drop a hat, and I'll drop the hat. I mean, I don't know why that happens sometimes, but I remember the beginning of my Christian life with regard to feelings. I remember when I thought, man, I'm just so stupid, man. I cry everything, and I keep on crying. People are gonna think this guy. Don't say anything to him about God. He'll just cry. You know, you're just ruining the whole day for everybody. You know? We all got to recover from it. He's standing there crying or whatever. But the bottom line is this: I started to think, you know, well, God, I need to quit this, you know? I need to stop doing this. And every time you're not blocking him, I'm going to cry about that. You know? But God said, no, this is something that you didn't do before. Something you didn't do before. That your hard heart is not hard like it used to be. And so let that happen. But I can tell you this. If you start having feelings that are contrary to the Word of God, you have a problem. And I'm not saying you got a serious problem, but you need to bring those feelings and connect them with the Word of God. For example, okay, you're not getting something that you've been praying for. God's not opening a door that you really believe, and it may be you really believe that it's the will of God for your life, and it's not happening. And you get frustrated. That's a feeling. You get mad. That's a feeling. You get impatient. That's a feeling that can lead to other feelings. Where the Bible says that my God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. What do? I apply the Bible to my feelings. And if it's frustration, I trust the Bible. And if it's impatience, I trust the Bible. And you say, well, Rick, that's easier said than done. But it can be done. But it can be done. And so if you go around, we'll be like this all the time. You know, and so that when we look about the feelings of the Christian life, it involves feelings, but it ultimately all has to boil down to and funnel down to the Word of God. The Word of God. There's many times we read verses in the Bible that don't appear, now that's the key phrase, that don't appear to be lining up with our life right now. It happens that way sometimes. What God's trying to do. I know in my life what he's trying to do is get me to trust him. Get me to trust him. I think it would be too easy if everything lined up every split second of our life. It would just be too easy. And I think most of us would take it for granted. You know what the ability to overcome those feelings when they're not happening now is, and I believe I can speak for the room, is look back at what God's already done. Where you had those feelings before, and God came through again. And he'll come through again. And so we talked about waiting, and some of those lessons are still back there. If you're having trouble waiting on God, pick up, I'm not sure which one it is, pick them all up, okay? And trust the Lord, and don't rely so much on your feelings. The person had been an enemy of God before, but when this change takes place, they begin to love God. And by the way, that is also a manifestation of you being saved. Love for God. You know, it sounds kind of gushy. I was telling somebody that I was witnessing one time, and talking about that, and you know, it wasn't really my intention to say it, but I suppose it just came out, and I just said, you know, they knew me from the past, and I just said, they said something about my past, you know, and you seem a little different, something like that, and I said, well, I just love the Lord. And that was such a strange phrase to them. I was like, what are you talking about? Love the Lord. You love God. Folks, that's more than a catchy phrase. That's more than a catchy phrase. We love him for a reason. And the primary reason is the cross, isn't it? But the response, our response to love God is based on his having already done that for us. Because that's what the Bible says. We love him because he first loved us. It's reciprocated. Most of us didn't love anybody that didn't love us. Most of us won't love anybody that won't love us. And we do that. Look at Colossians chapter 1 and verse 21. And you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now, here's present tense, he's talking to the believer in Colossians, has he reconciled in the body of his flesh through death, that's the cross, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable or unaccused or blameless in his sight. There lies again your position in Christ. That's how God sees you. He sees you holy, unblameable, and if you want to say blameless, that's a word that could be translated that unreprovable, which we use every day in our common conversations, unreprovable in his sight. That's the way God looks at you. Stop looking at yourself different than the way God looks at you. What if you want to talk about something that affects your feelings, that right there will do it. Look at yourself as we talk about in attitude number 4. I examine myself what? In the light of God's word. God looks at this room, if you're saved, he looks at this room as not sinless, as if never sinned, but positionally speaking, he looks at you as holy and blameless. Nothing that you will stand before God, at the day that you stand before God, will God bring up based on your sin. Done. It's done. I can't wrap my mind around that. Because sometimes that's all I do think about. Man, if we're going to be talking about my sin, y'all are going to have to wait in line for another 10 years. And I said, can you imagine what the wait would be for that? No, he said, no, I'm not going to talk about that. What I'm going to talk to you about, Rick, when you stand before me at the judgment seat of Christ, I'm going to talk about the way that you live since you've been saved. And it's not going to have anything, again, it's not going to have anything to do with your sin. You're blameless. It's going to have everything to do with your fruit. What did you do with your life since you've been saved? Did you take me up on the opportunities that I presented to you to be useful and fruitful in your Christian life? Were you kind? Were you doing the basic expectations of the Christian life? Did you love people? Did you have compassion for people? And if you don't have any homework to do in those areas, well, I'll sit down with you for an hour a week and you can help me with some of those things. Okay? And so as we look at it, that's your position. This change from enemy to friendship with God arises very much from a change of a person's position before God. I just said that. Before a person is saved, they are condemned. But when they receive spiritual life, we read, there is therefore no condemnation to those which are, what? In, there's that term again, in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. That's in Romans chapter 8, verse 1, if you want to look that up and underline it. This altogether changes our condition as to inward happiness. What are you talking about? Happiness is obviously an emotion, but it makes me happy to think that God loves me, and he paid the price for my sin, and I'm forgiven. That makes me happy. Happy, happy. Okay? I mean, I'm glad of that, because I couldn't do that for myself. And am I the only person in the room who's just trying to be good, be good, be good, mess up, be good, be good? That was just that roller coaster ride of life. And God says, no, I forgive you. You're not condemned. There's nothing between me and you, Rick, right now. The only thing that can be between me and God with regard to my sin is my fellowship with God. Not my relationship to God. I'm always his child. He's stuck with me. And he's stuck with you too if you're saved. Man, be glad you ain't God. Okay? Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. A peace we never had before. And I would, again, I say this and I'm going to keep saying it in these lessons. I would encourage you to go through these on your own. Some time that God will give you, and I know he will, to kind of sort out some of your thoughts on these things. You have some thought-provoking questions throughout this whole series, and do some of that. You know, it's homework that'll never be checked. It's the best kind. All right? When we study God's Word, we know the Scripture has but one meaning. But we also know that from the meaning, we can make many applications. In other words, when you read the Bible, it means one thing. You can apply it a lot of different ways, but it means one thing. Keep that in mind, or you're going to get, if you're not careful, you get all over the place. Right. Now that we have laid the foundation for what it means to be in Christ, and that's what these first previous 4 pages were, and knowing that old things are passed away, how can we apply this truth to our lives when it comes to having been down the road that perhaps many of us have traveled down? Since we know that the meaning of these old things are referring to our sins that separated us from having a relationship with the Lord, We would do well to identify some of them and stay alert to how our enemy, the devil, might still tempt us in some of these areas. The list may be exhaustive, and it could be. And again, I don't know if it's extremely productive. It wouldn't be as productive, as I said in the beginning, to continue to think about this old stuff, this old stuff, this old stuff. And I'm going to tell you the reason why in a minute. It would to identify and stay alert to how the enemy might tempt us. The list might be exhaustive, but we will consider some of the ones that are the most common for people trying to get clean and stay clean. And the first, and I think one of the most important of the old things, is what you see right there in bold print, underline. What is it? Old thinking. Old thinking. See, you're according to the theme verse, or the foundation verse for this whole series of lessons, in 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, that's what we just talked about, all of last time and this time, he is a
new creation.
And so, if a new creation keeps on living with old thinking, he's not going to find out what the new things are. He's not going to experience them to the degree that God would have them. Old behavior cannot take place, and that's why it's in bold print. Get a hold of that. Old behavior cannot take place without first being birthed by old thinking. Doesn't happen. It doesn't happen. In fact, you don't do anything. I know some of us would argue that, but you don't do anything without thinking first. And someone's saying, well, I must not have thought that much. You know what I mean? Oh, you thought. You thought. I have been around my share of environments, and I know that some of the people in this room that have been in the same environments would testify to the same thing that I'm fixing to say. But, you know, and I don't mean this to be humorous, so don't misunderstand this. People who do really, really crazy things and really tear up their lives does not necessarily imply that they're stupid. They might do stupid things. But I mean this, and I don't mean it in a humorous way at all. I want to make sure you understand that. Just because people do bad things doesn't mean they don't think. And some think really long and really hard, with a fair measure, in a lot of cases, of intellect. You know, you can be, and I don't mean this again, I'm putting a disclaimer on half the lesson here, but you can be a very, very smart fool. For your own bad, not for your good. And it's sad that I can speak to that on a personal level, not that I'm a real smart person. And it's sad that I even have to admit this, but I would, and I want to be transparent about it. Some of us got really good at being bad. I mean, it's you knew how to do what you were doing because you thought through it. And there is a lot of manipulation, and there's a lot of deception. In fact, all of it is. And while you're thinking you're getting better at something, you're getting worse. Yeah. It involves thinking. And the Christian life, you do not, by any means, check your brain at the door. You think about what you do, because if you don't, you're going to do what you used to do. Because you've been thinking about it. So that takes discipline, but you can't just, God doesn't expect just discipline. That's why we talk about, use that phrase, which is an application, out with the old, get it out, and in with the new. But if there's nothing coming in new, the old's going to stay.
Amen.
I mean, you cannot, Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, speak to that. You cannot renew your mind unintentionally. You do it intentionally. And so when we think about this old thinking, all of us have heard this, but only some of us are cautious when we're reminded of it. We might sometimes flirt with our old thoughts if we cannot dabble in our old behavior. And every, if you want to use the word relapse, every relapse starts with a thought. It may be split second, it may be a day, it may be 3 days, it may be 5 days. I've met them and I've been that person that can do a lot of good, knowing sooner or later they're going to get to do some bad. You know? Yeah, and just like you did, if you did stash your little substance or whatever it was, whether it was a $20 bill, and I don't want to get into any detail about it, just like you put that thing off into a place for a more convenient season or time, you do that if you're not careful with your thoughts. Well, I don't even be thinking like this right now, because if I'm thinking like this right now, it's not an opportunity for me to do what I'm thinking. What I got to do? I need to discard the thinking and turn it over to the obedience of Christ. I don't just stash the thought like I stashed that $20 bill. You know? I mean, $20 bill, you got to stash a whole lot more. And I got to clean another $20 bill. But I don't stash the thought anymore than I do that. What do? I confess it to God. It doesn't mean that I'm sinning against God when I'm having a thought, but I got to bring God in on it. I got to bring God in on it. I don't know about you, but I have been more so, you know, later in my Christian life, and I wish I was more so in the beginning of my Christian life, sensitive to what's going on in my head. And I don't know what's going on. I mean, and sometimes I don't know what's going on in my head. I can't remember half the things that are going on in my head, but I got to be sensitive to really identify, like, you know what, God, right now I'm being tempted. Right now I'm being tempted. You might be minding your own business. You know, I mean, you might be anywhere and not out of the will of God, but just be honest about it. Right now, God, I'm feeling just stupid in my thoughts. And just identify it and then confess it. Yes. And bring God in on it. Amen. And because if we don't, what we will do, knowing, listen, keep reading and then we'll get a little bit more further. Knowing that our thoughts are not so easily detected, we can liken this to our behavior as a child. When we would find something mischievous to do inside the house, when we were restricted from going outside the house. In other words, the punishment didn't adjust the behavior, it only changed the environment of it. So in other words, I'm restricted, I'm kept from doing what ultimately part of me wants to do. And so what I'll do is, I'll think about it. I'll think about what I want to do that I can't do. Well, if you keep thinking about what you want to do that you can't do, you're going to end up doing it. I mean, this is just, I could sit there with a bunch of sixth graders and they go, you're right, Mr. Ray, you're right. You know, it's exactly what we do. This is life. This is how we live life. But most importantly, it's about the Christian life. Because if we're honest with our thoughts, then we'll be more honest about our actions. Because there's something that happens between the thought and the action. It's a plan. It's a plan. I've seen it many, many times. And you that are in a structured environment right now, you get a hold of this and get a hold of it really well. I've seen people do really, really good in a program knowing they have no intention of doing good when they leave. I've seen it. I've seen it over and over and over again. I've seen professional rehab people. I mean, and it's sad. It's sad. They're the cream of the crop. They're the cast me out. They're the favorite of the director. I mean, they're the one getting flavor creamer. Nobody even knows about it. You know what I mean? Getting all the perks. They're all the perks. And don't listen. And don't set yourself up against somebody like that, by the way. If you already started thinking about anybody but yourself, quit that too. Okay? But before you know it, that person is so good. Listen, all of us know how to do good. We know how to be good. We do. Because there's people watching us all the time. You know, and especially when they are. And when they are, we want to prove that we're being good. Man, I just got here. I just brought you some coffee. Oh, you know, and that naive person, I ain't one of them people, that one of them, that naive person goes, oh, you got a servant's heart. Somebody bring me some coffee, I'm going to go, well, what's up with you, man? No, I'm going to go, oh, okay, hold on. I tend to speculate a little bit. You know what? I'm not saying that everybody's motives aren't pure when they give somebody a cup of coffee, but we're not always used to that, are we? We're not always used to seeing that. But I tell you what, when it happens for about 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, and they do things like that without anybody knowing, then you know that's usually a work of the Lord. That's a work of the Lord. If we do a bunch of good stuff to get other people to see us doing a bunch of good stuff, that's probably just a manifestation of what's going on the outside, and perhaps now what's going on the inside. Jesus spoke on that. He talked about that. Don't go out on the, I'll paraphrase it. Don't be like the Pharisees who go out in the corner and pray so everybody can hear them praying. You know, do this. You know, he said, get in, when he was referring to the prayer part, he said, get in your closet. He talked about fasting. He said, don't tell people that you're fasting to make it sound spiritual and stuff like that. Now, there's nothing wrong with sharing that with a friend and stuff like that. But the bottom line, he said, go do that alone. And so your Father that sees you in secret will reward you openly. You know, We're not trying to make a name for ourselves. We're trying to make a name for the Lord. But our thinking, let's just be honest. Our thinking can get a little bit, here's a real deep word for you, kooky. Okay? It can get a little bit kooky. You know? Whereas we're just, you know, we want to do, hopefully you want to do the right thing. Be honest with your thinking. So as we go along, we're going to start to wrap this up, like right now. We'll talk a little bit more about this. James chapter 4 and verse 14. This is probably a good place to wrap it up without just skimming over this. But every man is tempted. In fact, there's only a couple of them left, and I have more of them I'm going to bring over here this week, that temptation series. These verses are a little bit more in detail in that temptation series back there, where James says, every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust. Now, that's a person. That makes it personal. And that word lust doesn't necessarily mean, although it could include something sensual, but it's talking about desires. You have personal desires that are contrary to the will of God. Your flesh does. And so he says, every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own desires, we could say, and enticed. And that word enticed is the idea of being baited. That's kind of like the temptation itself. And so that's really something that's going on, and we'll talk a little bit more about it next week. That's really something that's going on when you're being tempted. It has everything to do with your thought life. Yeah. It has everything to do with your thought life. I mean, there's no way getting around it. It has everything to do with your thought life. So listen, get a hold of the thought life, and you're going to get a hold of the victory. And know what to do when it's going on, and you're going to be more prone to resistance than you are to giving in. And I learned this the hard way. Okay? I haven't mastered it, but I'll tell you what. I'm without excuse. And by the end of this lesson, so will you be. All right? We might be in different boats today. We're going to be in the same boat in about a week. All right? Let's go ahead and pray, and we'll finish this up. Father God, thank you. Thank you, Lord, that you have given us the mind of Christ. Thank you, Lord, that you have told us what to think about. And you have told us what not to think about. But I know, God, that we need your help to discipline ourselves, to keep our mind focused on the right things. Things that would be pleasing to you, that would be productive for you and us. And God, things you have shown us clearly, the things that wouldn't be. So God, help us to, especially for those who may still be in the struggle. God, there will be nothing productive or fruitful in any of our lives thinking about the old things that we used to do, that in some time of the day or the week or the month that we get attracted to doing again. There'd be nothing productive about that. So help us to not think about those things. Help us to discipline ourselves when we do, to give those thoughts to you and move on with our day and move on with whatever else you have for us so that those thoughts do not become a plan. I pray for every person in this room that may be struggling, God. I pray that you'd help them to see light at the end of that tunnel, to know that your word is sufficient, that a relationship with you through your Son, Jesus Christ, is everything that we need. And when we find that He's all that we have, we'll find for sure He's everything that we need. I pray for every person in this room that, God, they bear fruit this week. Bring others back on a Wednesday night or Sunday morning that we might be part or a link in the chain, perhaps to helping somebody else. Thank you for what you're doing in and through the lives in this place, in this ministry, around this place, and other programs that are affiliated with it. God, thank you so much for what you're doing because of your willingness to just inject your power in and through somebody's life that they might get the victory over the things that were trying to ultimately kill them. And God, now they're seeing, God, that there is victory in Jesus. Amen. And we give you the glory for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.